Welcome to the session. So we are discussing module 2. So in module 2, we divided for ease of learning, we divided this entire module 2 into three major parts. So first we are going to discuss about threads and multi-threaded programming as a first part. Second part, we are going to discuss about scheduling, process scheduling. Then as a third part, we are going to discuss about synchronization, process synchronization. So these are the divisions we made for ease of usage or and ease of learning with the with this particular second module. So according to the curriculum part of view, so this is one of the important chapter as a core chapter. So we are going to learn so many topics, threads, processes, and scheduling processes and synchronization in depth of this one. We'll begin with multi-threaded programming. So as a first part, we are discussing multi-threaded programming. So this is Pradeep Kumar from Department of CSE, AJIT Mangaluru. So to begin with multi-threaded programming, so we are covering this many topics under this, under threads. We'll just visit what is threads, what is process, and different definitions. And we are going to learn about multi-threading models, different models we are going to study, and some of the issues with the threads, and then pthreads. And as an example, as a simple examples, we are going to discuss about these three different models, these three different threads: Windows XP threads, Linux threads, and Java threads. Moving further, single and multi-threaded processes. So in general, a thread is nothing but it is a basic unit of a CPU utilization. So in general, we can say the process is nothing but a program under execution in the backend, right? So there is a process. Similarly, a thread is basic unit, smallest unit of a CPU utilization. So it consists of, so how to identify a thread? So it consists of a thread ID or thread sequence number or thread number, then program counter, a stack, and set of registers that we can see over here in this particular diagram. So a thread is nothing but it is a basic unit of CPU utilization, and it consists of a thread ID and program counter, then a stack, then set of registers related with that particular thread. So in general, traditionally, if you say, on the other hand, traditional processes may have single thread of control. For one particular process, we may need one single thread to handle that particular process, to look after that particular process. So that is nothing but it should look after the sequence of instructions that can be carried out in a given time. So that is via program counter. So what we have in the program counter, the next instruction, address of next instruction that is to be executed, right? So that is available in the program counter. So thread's job is to look after that particular scenario where the execution, whether it takes place systematically or no. So that is what the job of a thread. So now, one particular sequence of instructions that can be carried out on a program counter. So now, this particular job is looking after the thread. So this is also called as heavyweight process because it should look after all those. So when we say multi-threaded, so it will have more than one thread. Nothing but say on the other hand, multiple threads in a single process. Or on the other hand, sometimes it may be sharing a common code, common data, common files. It will share common code, common data, common files among these three threads. But there are different stack, different registers for each of the threads. So that is multi-threaded process. Multiple threads are joined together to look after the process. So by sharing common code, you can see in the diagram, common code, common data, and common files. So in this case, this is also called as lightweight process, because multiple tasks to perform independently of the others. So without disturbing others, multiple programs are executed in the backend. So in generally, it is these threads are very useful in a programming concept, where a particular process is under control, or process under execution. That is why using the latest modern programming technologies. And for example, if you consider with respect to a word processor or MS Word, Microsoft Word, so in the backend, a particular thread, maybe one particular thread may be checking your spelling, one particular thread may be looking after your indentation, another thread may be looking after your other, say, text. So these are the jobs of different threads. So in on a particular Microsoft Word document, so if you are, say, you are creating a new Word file, say you are creating a resume, in such cases, many, if there are multiple threads, then one single thread may be looking after the spelling, another thread may be looking after the indentation, another thread may be looking after what you type, say grammar. So that is how we can give an example for a multi-threaded process. So what are the benefits of having these threads? So these four are the major benefits of multi-threading concept. Multi-threading is nothing but having multiple threads to look after one particular process. So it will have a greater extent of responsiveness, saying that one thread may provide rapid response for a one particular situation, and other threads may be blocked at that particular period. So by using this one, so multi-threading may allow the program to continue running even if some part of it is blocked, or whether it is performing a lengthy operation on the other hand, so that you can make use of that particular program. Right, for example, if you consider MS Word, preparing a new document, so you can start typing. Right, so whenever you start typing, whether the particular word is complete or incomplete, but it will allow you to proceed further. Right, or if there is a mistake in the spelling and all, you can type another new word, so that the previous thread won't disturb you to continue with your work. So that is responsiveness. So via the help of multiple threads, you can carry out the job continuously, so that there is no need to wait to complete the task. So that is the responsiveness of the thread, one of the major benefits. Second major benefit is resource sharing. So when we say resource sharing, by default, if you look after the previous diagram, by default, the threads are sharing common code, common data, common files. There is nothing but resource sharing. So on the other hand, it is utilizing whatever the data, whatever the code, whatever the file is available for all these. So same code, same data, same files are usable for all these three threads. So there is nothing but resource sharing. On the other hand, which allows multiple tasks to be performed using same address space, same data, and same files. So that is resource sharing. And coming to the economy, so creating and managing threads, which is much faster than performing the same tasks for different processes, so that very easily we can create, we can manage with existing threads. So on the other hand, we have something called context switch. So nothing but switching between different switches, different threads, switching. So via having this context switch, we can switch over different thread during the execution. So that it will be easier to create and manage with the thread. And along with that, we have something called utilization of MP architecture. So MP architecture is nothing but multi-processor. as we know right now in the market, we are getting multiprocessor architectures. So we can easily utilize these with the multi-threading concept, multiple threading concepts, multiple threads, along with multi-processing as well, multiprocessor architecture as well. On the other hand, I'm trying to say a single thread process can make use of one CPU. So that is as we know. So when we have multi-threads, multiple threads can make use of multi-processing architecture with an easier way. So on the other hand, whenever we have multi-threading, so it utilizes the multi-processors so that CPUs concurrency or job concurrency and performance may be increased. So that is how utilizing multiple threads are utilizing multi-processors. So that we can have a scalability also, can have a greater performance also, we can have a robustness also via using this multiple threads. Moving further, so in general we have three primary thread libraries. So that is, when we say user threads, it is nothing but thread management. So who will manage that with respect to user level threads library? So we need thread library to look after this thread management. So under thread management, we can say we have POSIX, VThreads, Windows 32 threads, and Java threads. So these are the three primary thread libraries. So whenever we make use of threads, we must have these primary thread libraries, right? So POSIX, Windows 32, Java threads. On the other hand, we have kernel threads also. This is supported by the kernel. So with respect to kernel, if you say these are the examples, Windows XP or 2000, Solaris, Linux, True 64, Unix, Mac OS. So these are the different examples for kernel threads. We'll see in detail all these. Coming to the modeling, multi-threading models. So when we say multi-threading, we should have a multi-core programming also, saying that our processor, our multi-processor should allow to perform this multi-threading concept via supported by the multiple cores that we have in a single chip. Dual core, quad core, octa core, hexa core, all these are multiple cores, right, in a single CPU chip. So via using multi-threading, we can make use of all those cores so that the performance is increased, performance of machine is increased, timeliness is increased, delay is getting reduced. Right, so these are the benefits we have. So we'll discuss one by one. So we have three types of multi-threading models. One is many to one, one to one, and many to many. Many to one. So when we say many to one model, there are many user level threads, many user level threads, which are mapped to a single kernel thread. When we have many user level threads which are mapped to single kernel thread, we'll see that setup. So this is many to one model. So we have many threads, many user threads, thread 1, thread 2, thread 3, thread 4. So you can see in this particular diagram, right? So we have many threads which are mapped to one kernel head, saying that one particular kernel looking after these many threads, multiple threads. So that's why the name many to one model. So now what happens is, if whenever this particular, consider consider a numbering from left to right, 1, 2, 3, 4. Consider this thread one is looking after one particular task, thread two looking after another task under one single program. So a one program on the other hand, so one application may be running in the program. So in that one particular application, we have n number of threads which is looking after each individual task of that particular application. So during that particular period, say thread 1 wanted to convey something to the kernel head. So during this message passing, so other three threads may not be blocked or block, thus this particular execution may continue and complete. So that is many to one model. When we have many threads under one particular control and under controlled by one particular single kernel. So now the major thread management is handled by the thread library in this particular user space only, right? So by one of the threads, say for example, if they wanted to have a particular system call or wanted to convey something to the kernel, so then a blocking system call is made. On the other hand, entire process has been blocked for a temporary purpose, so that other user can continue with other user threads. So now what happens is, when we have this multiple scenario, only one thread can be accessed by the kernel at a time, because we have only one kernel head. So one kernel head will look after only one user thread at each time. So you can't have all these. Say only one user thread can access kernel at a time, because there is only one kernel thread. So what to do with these three during at that time? It should be blocked by the system call. For example, we can give an example of Solaris and GNU portable threads. So with respect to GNU portable threads, it is implemented, and Solaris green threads are implemented based on this particular principle, many to one model. So when we say many to one, many from the left hand side, many in the sense many number of or multi threads to one model, that is one kernel. Moving further, we have second type, that is one to one model. In this, each user level thread maps to kernel thread separately. For each user level thread, there are each single kernel thread always. So we have examples from Windows NT, Windows X, Windows 2000, and Linux, Solaris 9, and later on. So you'll see that how it is. So now one to one, please follow my cursor with the diagram. One to one model, one, these are all user threads. So for each individual single user threads, there are single kernel thread as well, so that each user level thread are monitored, maintained by kernel thread, single kernel thread. So that's why the name one to one model, only one thread with one kernel. So one kernel handle, or one kernel thread to handle each user thread, each individual users. So now what happens is, in previous model, in this case, if this particular thread wanted to communicate with the kernel, automatically these three threads should be blocked. That is one of the demerit, right? To avoid that scenario, here we can easily communicate. If this particular thread wanted to communicate with this kernel, automatically it comes, because we have only one separate dedicated path, right? So the overhead of managing one-to-one model is more significant, because it won't involve overhead with respect to the entire system, because we have separated kernel as well. But on the other hand, whenever there is a less number of threads are available, then the performance may decrease. Moving further, many to many model. So here in this case, many to many model, we have many user threads and many kernel threads. So the many to many model multiplexes any number of user threads onto an equal or small number of kernel threads. On the other hand, it is going to combine the best features of both one to one and many to many model. And here users won't have any restrictions on the number of threads that should be created or managed. And over here, the kernel system call do not block the entire process. We'll see that. We'll see the setup like this. So now in this case, we can say many to many model. There are multiple threads. We have multiple kernel threads also. So it is something like combination of both one to one model and many to one model. Here, as we know, there is no restriction because no need of blocking over here. And processes can be split across multiple process. So all these and individual processes may be allocated many number of or variable whenever they need variable number of threads, user threads, and as well for kernel threads also. It is also called as a two-tier model because we have two separate layers as user, many users, many user threads and many kernel threads. It is a two-tier model. So it is supported by, as we an example, we have Solaris version 9 onwards and Windows NT, Windows 2000 with the thread fiber package. So everything is come up with this particular package, thread fiber package. Moving further, two-level model, which is similar to many-to-many. Same thing, but little bit exception in such a way that it allows a user thread to be bound to kernel thread. It allows a user thread to be bound to kernel thread. As an example, we have Irix, HP's user X, True64 Unix, Solaris 8, and its previous versions. It's a previous version. This is how it is. Two-level model. So as we had many to many, along with that, we have one more additional kernel threads. So this is two level models with respect to. So rest of the things are same. It has same features as that of many to many. But over here, we have many to many plus one to one. So we have that advantages. Coming to the issues, threading issues. As we know, fork and exec system calls. What is the use of fork? Fork system call is used to create a separate process, thread process, right? And exec, using exec, we are going to execute it by the thread, whatever the thread we have created. So now using fork call, we can create a separate duplicate process. So now whenever a thread program calls that fork, what will happen in the backend? A new process can be a copy of the parent or group of all the threads with all the threads. On the other hand, the new process is a copy of the single thread that invoked the particular process, that is use of fork. So now when the thread invokes exec system call, this one exec system call, the program specified in the particular parameter will be executed. So what are the programs specified in this particular parameter? So that is executed by the thread, whichever the thread is created by this fork. So under this, we have thread cancellation also. We can have cancellation procedure also. On the other hand, cancellation is nothing but we are terminating the thread before it has to complete its task. So in between a particular thread's execution, in between the program execution, if you want to force it. So thread cancellation is nothing but forcing to terminate the particular thread before its execution gets completed. So now whatever the thread we wanted to cancel, that particular thread is called as target thread. Say you have a thread under execution. So during the execution itself, you are forced to stop it, or you are forcing to cancel the execution. So then whichever the thread we are going to cancel it, that canceled thread is called as target thread. For example, when we have multiple threads during loading a particular web page, say google.com, say whenever you type google.com in a browser's URL, automatically what will happen in the back end? The page will load it, right? So when the page is loading, a new form will be opened on your screen. So that particular page, web page, is having some buttons, some space or text area that where you wanted to type, and few buttons as well. So now each thread will look after these individual components of the web page. So now whenever you try to terminate it, whenever you try to close the web page before loading all those components, so that is whatever the component is trying to close, that is target thread. You are targeted one particular feature. If you are targeting one particular scenario, that is target thread. So using this thread cancellation, we can perform that also. So now when we say thread cancellation, so we can have these kind of scenarios. We can have asynchronous and deferred cancellations. So we'll see that part later. Okay, here. So we have thread cancellation, and then we have signal handling as well. We have thread pools. We have thread specific data and scheduler activations. We'll see in detail. Semantics of fork and exec we have seen just now. So fork is used to create a thread, or fork is to have a copy from the parent, creating a duplicate. And exec, using exec command, whatever the program you wanted to execute, that can be associated here. And using exec, the thread will execute that particular program. That is what we see. So thread cancellation, so terminating a thread before it has finished its execution. So we have two approaches. One is asynchronous and deferred. So asynchronous is nothing but using this asynchronous cancellation, we can terminate the target thread immediately. Immediately we can terminate, we can cancel it. We can target that particular thread and we can terminate its execution. And coming to deferred cancellation, it allows the target thread to periodically check if it should be cancelled. It may ask once again. For example, whenever you try to close a particular page, some of the web pages may ask you whether you wanted to close. Are you sure? Like a new, when some new message box may pop up and it may give you a prompt saying that, are you sure to terminate? So that is what deferred cancellation. So you have given the task of asking the user in such a way that whenever you force a particular thread to be terminated, at that time automatically the thread will be popped up and ask you periodically check if it should be cancelled. This is an example for that. So now what will happen is, whenever you agree during periodical checkup, automatically then it's getting cancelled. Otherwise, in the back end, it continues its execution by blocking other threads. So what will happen this one during or after the cancellation? Whatever the resources given for those particular threads, that will be accessed back to operating system. For example, say if you consider a web browser as an example, you wanted to search something on your web browser, say google.com. The google.com page is open now. So you wanted to search for a thread concept. You typed multi-threading and you pressed enter. And you got some new pages and you read that. So after finishing your reading, after getting the material, you will close that particular web page. That is, you're closing the web browser. So now after closing, what will happen? So whatever the resources supplied by the operating system to open that browser, that is terminated, and resources going back to the operating system, saying that resources will serve any other job. Right, so that is what this thread cancellation will happen. This is what operating system will perform in the back end. So it will reclaim all the resources. Moving further, signal handling. So signals are used in Unix systems to notify a process that a particular event has occurred. A signal which is used to notify a process. So now, for example, whenever you open, consider the same situation, you are opening a particular web web page using a browser. So now, whenever you click on that particular icon on your desktop or the screen, so what happens is in the backend, a system call should alert the kernel saying that you're supposed to wake up that particular application from sleep, or you're supposed to create a new window. On the other hand, using this signal handling, we can perform to notify a process to boot up, to notify a process to wake up from the call, wake up from the sleep. So how to do that? We need to have a signal handler. The signal handler is used to process signals. What it will do? A signal is generated by the occurrence. In general, a signal is generated by the occurrence of a particular event. So when something happens, automatically an alert should be given for other resources also. For example, say you opened a new Microsoft Word document, you typed something on that, you are trying to close it. So during whenever you press the close button, automatically it will ask you whether you wanted to save the file or discard. So that is what signal handling is. So whenever you try to close it before saving, it will give you a prompt, right? So that is what this particular signal handling will perform. So a signal is generated by the particular event. So what is that event? You are trying to close the page. What signal is generated? Signal is nothing but it will give you another message box saying that whether you wanted to close before save or you delete the particular file. So that is a signal. So now, once the signal is generated, it should be delivered to the process. A signal is delivered to a process. So over here, which is the process? Either save or discard. That is the process. So whichever the button you press on the screen with respect to MS document, so that is the process. So those will receive the signal. Then, whenever you press any one of the button, the signal is handled. So this is a three scenarios in the backend. Whenever a signal handler is used to process signals, generated using the to process the signals. Hope you got an idea, glimpse about this one, how signal works. Right? Okay. So now, a signal can be invoked in two different methodologies. One is again synchronous and asynchronous. Synchronous is nothing but signal delivered to the same program within the program itself. Asynchronous is sent to another program when there is another program. For example, consider a Microsoft document itself. Say you wanted to have content from one page to another page. You selected the initial Microsoft document page and you selected some area, some line, some sentences, and you press Control C or copying, and you move to second MS page and you're going to paste it, Control V. So whatever you have in Control C, whatever you copied in a clipboard, right? So that is asynchronous because you are passing the signal from one thread to another, one process to another. So that is asynchronous, another program itself. Or on the other hand, you can copy the content from Microsoft Word page to your mail also, some paragraph. Or you are copying content from a web page to your Microsoft Word file. That is asynchronous. You are passing some document, some command from one program to another program. That is asynchronous. Synchronous is within the same program. To handle with this signal handlers, we have some options. The options are, the first option says, deliver the signal to the thread to which the signal applies. Deliver the signal to the thread to which the signal applies. So consider the same previous example. You are preparing your resume initially. So before saving your document, after some edit operation, you're directly trying to terminate it. So at that time, a prompt will appear saying that whether you wanted to discard or save. So now what happens if that particular message box message may be displayed in a browser? Right, that is wrong. So that is what this particular signal handler will perform. Supposed to deliver the signal to the thread to which the signal applies. So from which thread it invoked that particular signal. So to that particular thread itself should support to give a signal. That is one option. Second option says deliver the signal to every thread in the process. For every thread in the process, for example, consider you created around 3 to 4 pages of document. You wanted to have header and footer. You go to insert and you type something that is to be inserted for header and footer. So after that, once you type that, it will give you a prompt saying that whether you wanted to have for every page of the document. So that is what the second point says, second option says. Deliver the signal to every thread in the process, whether you wanted to have that particular header and footer in all the pages. If that is the case, for all the pages should be copied like this. So in this particular slide, I have our college logo and my name in this footer. So this is applied for all the slides. So all the slides will have same thing. So that is what this second point says. Deliver the signal. I have delivered this particular signal to every slide. Understood? Fine. Third option says deliver the signal to certain threads in the process. Only for few. Only for first page. Only for last page. So that is delivering for a specific threads in the process. That is third option. Fourth option says deliver the signal or assign a specific thread to receive all signals for the process. We may have a specific thread. We can assign a specific thread which will receive all the signals. So we can have a superior, we can have a, say, a master. So he'll look after all this. So one thread may be given the task of receiving whatever the signal is sent by the process. So that is fourth option. So any clarification, any doubt so far? Okay. So we have thread pools also. Thread pools. So in this thread pool, this is the next criteria, thread pool in our list of issues, thread pool. So here thread pools are nothing but which will create a number of threads in a pool where they await work. So in general, we are going to create a number of threads in a pool so that they can wait for the work. So what are the advantages of this one? So we can have a faster service whenever there is a request with an existing thread. So you can this particular, whatever the thread already created, so it can continue the work, continue the job. And it may allow the number of threads in the applications to be bound to the size of the pool. For example, we can give an example. For every service, there should be an thread. For example, say consider a situation. You are searching something on your web browser. So you opened a Google Chrome. Home page appeared. Google.com. So you're supposed to search something. Say multi-threading. You are searching in your web browser. So whenever you press enter, automatically so many links will appear. So what are these links? These links are supplied by from various resources or various sites. It will have site link also or link to the various sites, right? So now, if you have these links under number of threads, you have pool of answers, you have group of answers. Whenever you need, you can utilize, you just click on that particular link and you can utilize the answer. So that is the use of beauty of thread pools. So each time, no need to type each time no need to open a new browser page and you need to type new link again and again whenever you have all the links in single page. That is what this thread pool means. So instead of creating new threads every time whenever a thread is needed, automatically we can call from this particular thread pool and you can utilize the service. Because there is much time is consumed in creation of the thread. But one limitation is there in this also, that is the number of active threads. How many number of active threads can be pooled together? Because unlimited thread creation may exhaust system resources also. Because it will just, you will create and sit idle. What is the use? Just making use of the resources of the machine, of the OS. No use, right? So that's why, so these are all the advantages we're supposed to take care about this one also. And coming to the advantages of this thread pool, sir, you can have immediate execution. You can continue with your immediate response by the threads. You can utilize any one of the thread. You can utilize any threads which are already waiting in the pool. That is one of the advantage. Second advantage is no need to waste the time for a thread creation also. Time utilization. Because we are utilizing the which are already existed in the thread pool. And servicing request, the time taken to servicing a request is very less when compared with the previous case. Right, so these are the advantages of thread pools. But who will identify this one? Who will look after this number of threads? Because number of threads are determined by the number of CPUs in your system. So based on that, it will identify. This is one of the important part. So you should know that. So based on number of CPUs, number of processors in your machine, based on that, number of threads in thread pool are decided. Okay. Moving further, thread specific data. So over here, thread specific data or data of a thread. So allows each thread to have its own copy of data. Because whenever a thread is created, it's nothing but is inheriting property, inheriting all those properties from its parent. That is one part. Second part is it may have its own copy of data for a particular version. So on the other hand, how to have a own copy of data? So whenever the data is not shared, then whenever the data is not inherited from the parent, then the particular thread will have its own copy of data. That is what this particular sentence means, point says. So allows each thread to have its own copy of data. Both are allowed. So one part is we can inherit, the thread can inherit the properties or data from the parent. Second part is thread can have its own data by does not inheriting from the parent thread. For example, when we have multiple transactions, because consider a bank situation, bank transactions, you are in between transferring 1,000 rupees to your friend. You are almost done. You give a account number, you give IFSC code, all those. If you're about to press submit button or transfer button, automatically your internet goes off. So in the back end, whether the transaction should happen or no, because you yet to press the transfer button. So what to do? Whenever internet comes back or whenever you get the network proper, again you start from the beginning. So now this is advantages with respect to bank transaction is concerned with. Right, so that is how this allows each thread to have its own copy of data. This particular sentence is meaningful in that particular sense. So now, this particular thread specific data is useful when you do not have control over the thread creation process. Because whenever you are using it from a thread, from a thread pool, so then this is thread specific data is very much useful. Moving to scheduler activations, that is the last part under threading issues, scheduler activations. In this case, both many-to-many and two-level models require communication to maintain the appropriate number of kernel threads allocated to the application. So what we are trying to say is, so scheduler activation, which is nothing but a technique which is used for communication between user thread library and the kernel, because someone should be in a position such a way that they can handle this particular request, right? So somebody should be there to convey the message. So scheduler activation, which is a technique which is used for a communication from user thread library. So we have listed several libraries, Win32, Mac OS X, or Solaris 9. So all this, and the with the kernel and with the library. So there should be a communication should happen. So this communication technique is nothing but scheduler activation itself. So how it works, how this particular communication works, it works like this. The kernel must inform the application first about certain event should happen. So what to do with that? Whenever the kernel informs the application, then it should provide a up call. So it is a communication mechanism from the kernel to the thread library, something called up call, a term called up call. So up call is a communication which is happened, communication mechanism from the kernel to the thread library, because something is going to happen. So alerting is nothing but alerting. And who will look after this? Who will look after these up calls? We have a handler also. We have up call handler. So this up call handler will handle all these activations, scheduler activations. And it will run on a virtual processor also. So what is the advantage? It will allow an application to maintain correct number of kernel threads. So say, why we need to have this correct number? Because we make use of both many-to-many and two-level models. So in such cases, when we say many-to-many, there may be thread pools also, more number of threads, but we doesn't know the exact number of threads. So using this upcall handlers, we can manage with the correct number of kernel threads. That is why I'm using upcall handler. Okay, any doubt or any clarification on this? Okay, so moving further. Pthreads, we are discussing different thread libraries. So we are going to discuss pthread, the POSIX pthreads, and Windows 32 threads, Win32 thread, and Java thread as well. So these are the different thread libraries we already discussed. It will provide an API for creating and managing threads, as we know. And it will be implemented either in user space or kernel space based on the usage. If it is user space, then it is application specific. If it is in kernel space, it is resource specific. Based on that, it is implemented. The three main thread libraries in use are POSIX pthreads. So these pthreads will provide either a user or kernel library as an extension based on this POSIX standard. So now a POSIX standard, so that is IEEE 1003-1C, it is an API for thread creation and synchronization. So using this pthread for POSIX, it is either user or kernel library as an extension, right? So it is nothing but API for creating. So this particular API specifies behavior of the thread library, whether it is implemented up to development of the library or continuation of the current scenario. So what else it will do? It will define the specification for pthreads, for this particular pthreads, and it doesn't specify any implementations because we already know why that particular thread is used, right? So this will handle the particular process in the backend. So these pthreads are common or commonly available with respect to these machines, Solaris, Linux, Mac OS X machines, or whoever or whichever the operating system which works on the principle of Unix, on the base on Unix platform. So all those machines uses POSIX standard IEEE 1003.16. So what happens over here is, so one thread supposed to wait for others to join before continuing. It will wait for the thread for continuation of the jobs. So it will begin execution in a specified function. So using a function called runner, we'll see that part later, which is used along with the create function to create a thread. So any clarification on this? Okay, coming to Windows XP thread. So this particular scenario implements one-to-one mapping. So as we saw, the types many-to-one, one-to-one. So this is under one-to-one mapping. Because why are using one-to-one? Each thread will be allocated for a particular application, particular process. So each thread will have its own thread ID, its own registers, separate user and kernel stacks, and will have its own data storage area. This is what we saw in the diagram. So if you want to have a look in the diagram, so this is what it is. The first diagram over here. So this is single threaded process. Each thread will have its own code, its own data, its own file, its own stack and other registers. It is not sharing. Individual responsibility can be handled via this. So it will have its own thread ID, register set, separate user and kernel stack, private data storage areas, right? So all these together, we are calling it as context of the thread, context of the thread. So now the primary data structure to utilize in the program, the primary data structures of a thread, it includes E thread, nothing but executive thread block, K thread, that is kernel thread block, and thread environment block, so TEB. So these three are the basic data structures when you wanted to have these particular threads in the program or in your application. So E thread corresponds to executive thread block, K thread corresponds to kernel thread block, TEB corresponds to thread environment block. Then we have a Linux thread. So Linux refers to them as tasks rather than thread. We use the terminology task. Over here, the thread are created using clone system call, clone. However, clone is nothing but we are inheriting the property from its predecessor. So clone allows a child task to share the address space of the parent task. So parent task is nothing but a process, right? So that is a Linux thread. So only one difference is here we use the term task, and using clone we are going to create the thread, clone system call. Coming to Java thread, it is managed by the JVM. It is created either using a two different methodology. One is via extending thread or via implementing the runnable interface. This is about the JVM. So all these Java threads are handled by Java Virtual Machine, JVM. Two methodologies, one is extending the thread, second one is implementing runnable interface. These are the two methodologies we can have under threads, when we can have under Java threads, which is managed by the Java Virtual Machine, JVM. So we'll see that. So the Java threads are, we already familiar with this, just we'll have a recap. So whenever a process is created, new process should be created. So we have these four stages of thread life cycle. We can say a new, a state, runnable, dead, and block. whenever a new thread is created, so whenever initially a thread is created, is in the new state, and then it is moved to the runnable state when we call start. Then, so using runnable methodology, using run method, we can utilize the implementation and continue with the thread functionalities, and we are going to exit out of it. That is, we are saying that it is dead, terminated. Or in between, we can block it. We can block the thread also. So whenever, on the other hand, we are trying to say, so whenever a new thread is created, doesn't mean that it is already started with the execution. Whenever you utilize, you're supposed to have start method, right? With respect to Java threads. Without using start thread, it won't get utilized. So that is why we are stressing on this particular Java thread states. So that is about Java threads and different threads. So any clarification, please revert back. Okay, we'll continue after a small break.